Map projections. Before we understand the concept of map projection, let's first talk about why do we actually need a projection. We have always seen representation of Earth through globe. So here we have a globe. Now this globe is able to represent the surface of the Earth, but the surface of the Earth explained through globe has certain issues, and therefore we prefer that rather than going for a three-dimensional view, we also require a two-dimensional view of the Earth's surface. And when we are requiring a two-dimensional view, that means this three-dimensional globe is being cut with a scissor. That's something that you can understand. And when I'm cutting this globe and I'm opening this up, there are distortions. These distortions can be in area. These distortions could be in shape, in size, or in direction. So those are the four major distortions that could be seen once you are cutting a spherical surface and trying to represent into a sheet of paper. And therefore, whenever we are focusing on map projections, there are certain distortions that are seen. But let's say I'm trying to use the globe itself. Now, when I'm trying to use the globe itself, what are the things that I'm trying to focus? Globe, first of all, is definitely bulky to carry. I cannot take it from one place to another constantly. It is difficult. It is bulky to carry. Also, it is expensive. Traveling with a sheet of paper is much more convenient, much more easier. Then, representation on the globe. Now, representation on the globe, when I'm saying I'm focusing on North America, let's say. Now, this section of North America is very, very small. If I want to zoom this out and I want to show the specific regions of North America, is it possible on globe? Definitely not. So, what you can do on a sheet of paper is take a specific area, enhance it and magnify it, and then show the various finer details, and those could be possible through map. And therefore, a three-dimensional surface could be brought onto a two-dimensional surface. And on paper, when you are drawing, we have a sample from Atlas here. As you can see, this is the region of Europe that is being drawn, and the lines that are running here are the projections. Now, in some of the cases, these projections are curved lines. In other of the cases, you would see straight lines that are there. So, when you are creating a projection, that we will understand in a while how to create the projections, you would see that either these could be curved lines or these could be straight lines that could be drawn. Also, there is one important thing that we need to focus on. However, this is something that you have been studying from your very primary classes, are the concept of latitudes and longitudes. So the lines running parallel to the equator are the latitudes, and in a scientific language, if I want to say the angle subtended from the center of the Earth, so this is the Earth, from this sphere, the center of the sphere, if I am drawing one line horizontally and trying to subtend an angle, that creates the latitude. So let's say I'm drawing a 20 degree angle here. So let's say this is the sphere. I'm cutting this sphere and I'm taking the center of the Earth, and from here I subtend an angle of, let's say, 30 degrees. So this would be the 30 degree parallel that would be drawn. Okay, and then the parallels do not intersect one another. However, when we focus on meridians, these meridians meet at the geographical north and south poles that are there. So those are some of the important terms. Parallels, also called as the latitudes, and then you have the meridians, which are also known as the longitudes. So a basic terminology to begin with. Now let's move on to the important concept. Why do we need a projection? Why do we need a projection is another interesting question. The first thing is, as we said, the region of North America that we were focusing on the globe could be explained in detail. So any region, North America was just an example. So understanding the region in detail is one of the basic advantages that could be seen. The second is, if I want to compare two natural regions, I can take, let's say, the region of Europe. I can take a region of South America. If I want to compare those two regions, I can have two of the maps that are there simultaneously and I can easily compare those. But carrying two or four globes is definitely a difficult task. Also, we are trying to transfer the latitudes and longitudes that we have done on the sheet of paper. And as we said, when you have a three-dimensional spherical surface which is being cut. Now, when this spherical surface is being cut, what would happen? There would be distortions. Obviously, when I'm cutting this and opening this, what would happen? Towards the polar areas, the things would not be exact and there would be distortions that would be maximum towards the polar areas. Now, this distortion, where do they occur? And in which regions they are maximum depend on the either the light source or the developable surface that we would understand in a while. Again, latitudes and longitudes we have understood. Whenever, this is just outside this concept, but just for your information, let's say there are two locations on the globe, location A and location B. A person wants to fly from location A to location B. What would be the shortest path? The shortest path would always be following the great circle, and that would be the shortest path on the globe. So those are some of the important things that we have understood here. Besides this, understanding how do we preserve the three important distortions, those are the distortions of area, distortions of shape and distortions of size. Now, when the distortions of a given area, a correct shape of a given area is to be maintained, we say that this is a orthomorphic projection. So the word used is orthomorphic. We would be coming to all these terms once again. And then you also have a method where equal area is being preserved, and this is known as homolographic. Okay, to begin with, understanding how the elements of map projection are taken into account. So elements of map projection are basically four. What are the major elements? The first element here is the reduced earth. What do we mean by reduced earth? Reduced earth means the actual thing on the ground is being reduced through a means of a scale, and that scale represents how many centimeters or how many kilometers on ground would be equivalent to how many centimeters on the sheet of paper. It could be the unit of kilometers or centimeters, it could be miles and inches, any unit that you are trying to use. Okay, so the scale basically explains the real distance on the ground versus the distance on the sheet of paper. So reducing earth is one of the most important things. The next important thing is the parallels or the latitudes, how those would be defined, how we would be drawing the parallels and longitudes we would understand in a while. The third is definitely if you are drawing the parallels, the map would be incomplete if there are no meridians or no longitude. So you have meridians that would be drawn. And the fourth and the most important is the global properties. Now, these global properties are what? As we said, trying to best maintain the area, the shape, the size, and the direction. So those are the key things that you are trying to maintain when you are representing this globe on a sheet of paper. To begin with, we can classify map projection in various ways. So we would focus on four ways through which we can actually classify the map projection. Global properties, since we have understood in the previous section, those are the most fundamental, so we'll start with this. Under the global properties, we have the area, shape, direction and distance that are maintained. When I am saying that I am maintaining the area, that means these are equal area projection. That means whatever latitudes and longitudes are being drawn, the area of A, B, C, D would be equal here. And therefore, we call it as this name itself, equal area projection. The next one is maintaining the shape. As we already said, this is orthomorphic morphic. So I am trying to best maintain the real shape of each of the continents. So let's say if my projections are too much diverted, the shape of Africa could get larger, the shape of Africa could get reduced. To avoid all those kinds of changes and fluctuations in the originality, we say it must be true to its shape. True shape is also known as orthomorphic projection. We'll see in a while which of the projections are orthomorphic, which of the projections you have conservation of area and so on. The next is direction. The idea is azimuthal projection, as it is called, as or maintaining the true bearing. Bearing explains the direction. So true direction is being maintained by the azimuthal projection, and this shows the direction of all the points from the center, and it says that the direction of point A, B, C and D is being equally and correctly represented. So what is the idea under direction? Conserving or maintaining the direction is true direction, which is known as azimuthal projection. And finally, we have maintaining the true distance, which is also known as equidistant. Now, of these, definitely equal area and the area where you are trying to preserve the area is called as equal area. Where you are trying to preserve the distance, it is known as equidistance. Those two are the most simplest and the easiest things to remember. So the distance from point A to B in this scenario would be maintained, and that would remain the same, be it the North Hemisphere, be it the South Hemisphere, or be it the region of equator. So that is one type of map projections. Coming on to the next is based on the drawing surface. Based on the drawing surface, I can say the projection can be perspective, non-perspective, or mathematical. Perspective implies that I am focusing a light source on the object. So let's say this is the earth, and on this earth I have a torch that is glowing here, and this light source is being maintained, and with that we form a drawing surface. The light and the imprint on the sheet of paper would be understood, and that would give me a projection, and this would be known as a perspective projection. Non-perspective projection, definitely if perspective requires light, non-perspective would require no light source. So there would be no casting of light that would be done on the globe in the case of non-perspective projection. The last is mathematical or conventional projections. Now these were some of the most ancient kinds of projections, and these were based on mathematical calculations. Good example are Mollewit projection, sinusoidal projection, which is also known as Samson-Flamsteed projection, and then you have Homolocene projections, as you can see here. The next is based on the developable or the non-developable surface. So globe is considered as a non-developable surface. I cannot develop this on a flat sheet of paper with good accuracy, and this is a non-developable surface. Then how do we define developable surfaces? Developable surfaces can be defined in numerous ways. Let's say I take a cone and I keep this cone on this earth. So consider this to be earth. Okay, now I am keeping the cone here. Now when I am trying to represent the region which is being covered by the cone on the sheet of paper, which is here, I'll just simply open it up, and this would show the drawing of half of the earth. So I am representing, let's say, North Hemisphere or South Hemisphere, whatsoever we are trying to take on the sheet of the paper, through a conical projection. So this is known as conical projection. The next way of representing is I take the earth, and on the earth I develop a cylindrical projection. So I develop a cylinder around the earth's surface, and what I do is I try to take an imprint of the earth's surface on the sheet of paper, and this would show me a cylindrical projection. The next type of projection is the zenithal projection. Now zenithal projection means the plane surface is tangent, that means, let's say this is the plane surface and this is tangent to the sphere, that means it touches the sphere on just one point. Now, there could be three kinds of zenithal projection. One is when it is touching the pole area. So, this is the north pole and the south pole where my fingers are. So, let's say this is touching the south pole on the sheet of paper. So, this becomes a polar projection. Now, where my fingers are now is the equator. Now, if this sheet of paper touches here, it becomes equatorial projection. And when the sheet of paper touches somewhere between the equator and the pole, that is this region, this becomes a oblique projection. So, there are three kinds of further projections that we can understand from the zenithal projection. So, first of all, within the developable surfaces, you have a cylindrical projection, a conical projection and a zenithal projection. Zenithal projection, if it is on the poles, it would be considered as a polar projection. If it is on the equator, it would be an equatorial projection. If it is somewhere between equator and pole, it is considered as an oblique projection. So, those are the important types of projections based on developable surface. Coming on to the last and the most interesting one, and that is based on the source of light. Now, based on the source of light, I have this sphere again here. Where is my source of light? Source of light could be on three of the places. If I am trying to track this place, I can keep the source of light opposite to it. My source of light could be infinite, or my source of light could be within this center. Let's say I dig a hole and put a torch there. So, that would be the source of light. So, three different sources of light that could be seen here. Now, the first source of light which I say is in the center of the globe is known as the gnomonic projection. The next is when the light source is diametrically opposite to the region that I am trying to trace. In that case, I am having the light from here trying to trace the other region. That would be known as the stereographic projection. And the last one here is the orthographic projection, where the light source is actually coming from infinite. So, those are the important types of projections and the classifications of projections that we have seen. Now, we have a list of some of the examples from cylindrical projections. So, equal area, equidistant cylindrical projection, Mercator, Miller are some of the good examples, and you can see how they look like. The next is the examples of conical projection. When I say conical projection, some of the most important ones are the conical projection are Elbert's equal area projection, equidistant projection and Lambert conformal projection. When I say azimuthal projection, some of the common ones are the Lambert polyconic projections. Those you can see here. So, those are some of the common types of projections. Now, what we would do today is try to understand how we actually draw a projection. You might have seen atlases with numerous projections. So, if you pick out any of the good atlases, you would see the map, and in the bottom it would be written the kind of projection that has been used in the atlas. Now, how these projections are actually drawn on the sheet of paper? So, we would be covering three important projections today. Mercator projection is the first projection that we would cover. Mercator projection was developed by Kramer. He was a Dutch scientist, and he tried to use mathematical formulas to calculate and to develop a projection. There was no other concept that was used, and the idea was that the parallels and the meridians would intersect one another. So, how this projection was developed, and also a straight line which joins any two points of the projections with constant bearing is known as the rhomb line or the loxodon. So, that was the basic idea that was used by Kramer. Now, let's have a simple question and solve that to draw a projection. So, the first here is we are trying to draw Mercator projection on a scale of 1 is to 250 million at 15 degrees interval. Now, we already know 250 million, if that's the radius, it is in the units where I can explain it as inches. So, I say the radius of the reduced earth would be how much? 250 million divided by 250 million. And that would give me how much? That would give me 1 inch. So, the radius of the earth here is 1 inch. Now, what would be the length of the equator in this case? The length of the equator would be 2 pi r. Now, 2 pi r is 2 into 22 by 7 into 1, which is the radius of the reduced earth that we have calculated. So, it comes out to be 2.68 inches. Now, since I have 2.68 inches, what I would do is, I'll draw my line of 6.28 inches. So, I start drawing a line of 6.28 inches. Now, since the question says we have to find at an interval of 15 degrees, how many total degrees? 360 degrees. Now, 360 divided by 15 would give me 24. So, if I am trying to explain or break down this 6.28 inches into 24 parts, each part would be how much? It would be 0.26 inches. So, I have 0.26 inches each part. So, what I do is, I divide this line into 0.26, 0.26, 0.26, 0.26 and so on. So, this explains my division of the lines here. Now, with the lines, I am trying to have the 0 degree that is being drawn. Now, with the 0 degree, I'll be moving north and south. So, north would be 2.6. Okay, now the next north would be that, the next would be that, so the distance from the 0 degree, but 90 degrees would actually not be able to be presented on a Mercator scale because the dimension would be so large that 90 degree would be nearly infinite. So, what we would be able to trace is only till the region of 75 degrees north and south. And even in that case, the region between the 60 to 75 shows a huge distance, and that actually shows what? That shows a huge amount of distortion. So, this Mercator projection is best used for regions lying on through the region of equator. What are the properties of Mercator projection? As we have the Mercator projection with us, the properties are very, very clear. The parallels and the meridians are straight lines. They intersect at right angles, 90 degree. The spacing increases as we move away from the region of equator. When I say spacing increases, the area gets deformed. So, for small countries near equator, this projection is perfectly used. So, let's say if I am trying to draw the countries of Africa, the Congo and the nearby countries in any of the regions crossing equator, Mercator projection would be one of the best projections to use. Also, this is orthomorphic, that means the scale of the projection is equal to the scale along the parallels that are there. But there is one of the major limitations. The major limitation is exaggeration of the polar areas, and for this reason, this was one of the maps that was used by Britishers when they were trying to expand their colonies. So, what they did was, they drew their maps on Mercator projection, creating Britain extraordinarily larger as compared to other countries and explaining the power of Britain in contrast to other nations, because since the region towards the pole gets enlarged, their country gets bigger and the other countries become smaller. So, they can explain their power and supremacy over other countries on the globe. So, exaggeration of the polar regions was one of the concepts that was being related to it. And also, if we talk about Greenland and the size of United States, we would see Greenland is huge, and the size of United States would be only 1/10 of Greenland in the case of a Mercator projection. So, that was about the Mercator projection. But as we said, equatorial regions can be best represented by it. It is widely used for navigation for sailors who are traveling or traversing small distances, and it is used to explain ocean currents, drainage patterns, winds, any monsoonal disturbances in the regions closer to equator. So any phenomena that you are trying to explain in and around equator, this is one of the very good projections, because there is conservation of shape and size and area that is being maintained in the region of equator. Also, Mercator is an azimuthal projection that we have seen. Coming on to the next projection. So one of the projections that we have covered was the Mercator projection. The next is a cylindrical, and the next would be a conical. So cylindrical equal area projection. Now here I have a RF of 300 million and the latitudinal and longitudinal extent is how much? The latitudinal and longitudinal extent is again 15 degrees interval that I am taking. So again 360 divided by 15 gives you 24. So my calculations would pretty much remain the same here again. So getting easier for you. Now, first I am trying to calculate the radius of the reduced earth. Now, since I am using this in centimeters now, it is 640 into 10 raised to power 6 divided by 300 into 10 raised to power 6. So in centimeters, it comes out to be 2.1 centimeter. That is the radius of the reduced earth. Coming on to the length of the equator, which is 2 pi r, I substitute r with 2.1 and this comes out to be 13.2 centimeters. Now, what I do is, I take my radius is 2.1, so I take the radius of 2.1 centimeters with the compass and I draw a circle on the sheet of paper. So, I draw a circle with a radius of 2.1 centimeters. Now, with this 2.1 centimeters, I mark the various angles at an interval that is given, which is 15 degrees. So this is 15, 30, 45, 60, 75 and 90. So I mark all the angles here. Now, once I have drawn all the angles from this equator, I will draw a line of 13.2 centimeters, which is the length of the equator. Now, this would be my end point, and this 13.2 centimeter line would be divided into how many parts? It would be divided into 13.2 divided by 24, which is 0.55 centimeter. So, this line of 13.2 centimeters, I would further divide into intervals of 0.55, 0.55, and there would be 24 sections that would be drawn. Now, since I have drawn all the angles, I'll draw straight lines from those angles and then I'll draw vertical lines at a distance of 0.55, and there would be 24 such lines. So, the middle one would be 0 degree meridian, and then you would have 180 degree east and west that would be drawn. But as you can see, once we have the final projection that is ready, there is very much high distortions that are seen towards the polar areas. In contrast to the Mercator projection, where we have seen that the polar areas get enlarged, here the polar areas are squeezed. So very small polar areas, as you can see here. So one of the major limitations, as we can see, this is non-orthomorphic projection. The distortions become very large as we move closer to the polar areas, and the equality of the area can be maintained only at the cost of distortion of the shape. If I am distorting the shape that could be seen in the polar areas, I am trying to maintain the equality of area. So that is at the cost of the distortions of the shape. All the meridians here, the parallels and the meridians, are straight lines. They cut across at 90 degrees and the scale is true only at the equator again. So this projection, if you can see, would be best for the region at 45 degrees north and south. So at the region of 45 degrees north and south, maximum characteristics would be maintained, and therefore it is suitable to show crop distributions of vegetations like sugarcane, tea, coffee, maize, rice, those mainly growing in the regions of 45 degrees north and south. So those are the classic characteristics of the equatorial equal area projection. The last projection that we would cover today is a conical projection. Now understand, the calculations and the process of developing a conical projection very, very carefully. It is a bit different from what we have done so far. So in a conical projection, we have one standard parallel. Now, what do we mean by one standard? We are taking a case of one standard parallel. There can be two standard parallels, or there could be multiple standard parallels. So if there are multiple, we call it as polyconic. Here we are talking about a simple conical projection. So let's say I have a cone here. I am putting this on a sphere. Now what would happen in this case? In this case, I am trying to touch the surface of the globe only once. And since it is touching only once, the region where it would be touching would be the region of standard parallel. So that is the concept of standard parallel. So as we can see in the diagram here, we have the globe. On the globe, the place where the cone is being touched, okay, that is the standard parallel. What I take is I draw the equator. From the equator, I draw 10 degrees since the question says 10 degrees interval. So first of all, I'll have to find out my standard parallel, okay. So the difference is 10 degrees to 70 degrees. So 10 to 70, I write 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70. What is the mid value? 40. So here you have 40 degrees north, which becomes the standard parallel. That means the point where the globe is being touched by the conical surface is 40 degrees north. We are talking about north hemisphere. Okay. So this is the 40 degree north, which is the standard parallel. Now we have found out the standard parallel. We would also find out the mid, the central meridian in this case. Now, longitudes, we are saying, extends from 10 degrees to 130 degrees east. 10 degrees east to 130 degrees. So, I take the mid value of that, which becomes 70 degrees east. Okay. Now, what I do is, I draw an angle of 40 degrees. This 40 degree angle would be the point where I have the standard parallel that would be drawn. I'll subtend two tangents from the two points that are being touched by the sphere, and those two would meet at a point P that we have located here. Now, I draw a straight line towards the center of the earth, and the point where I am having a 40 degree line and the vertical point from PO that could be seen, I would draw a straight line, and this is something that I mark as x and y. So I'll take the distance of this x and y. I'll also take the arc difference from C to E, which is 10 degrees. Okay. Now, this distance O to P that I have taken would become my radius. So with this radius, I would draw a arc. So I'll draw an arc with a radius of OP on a different sheet of paper. So I've just taken this circle and this is sphere to understand. Now once I have the values that I have here, I draw an arc at a distance of how much? At a distance of OP, that is here. And with this distance, I'm trying to draw a arc. The same distance I'm using to draw one of the arcs. Then I calculate the radius of the reduced earth. The radius of the reduced earth is how much? It is 2.56. Now, once I have the radius of the reduced earth, which is 2.56, I have drawn a line which is equivalent to 2.56 in this case. I have taken a line of 2.56 that I have drawn here. Okay. Now, once I have drawn this line, I will start to take the distance x and y. Now, this distance x and y and the arc distance C and E are important. So, this arc distance would be the distance that I would be cutting for the various parallels that would be drawn from the periphery. So, I take the distances and I cut this based on the CE distances, and based on the XY distance, I cut the standard parallel vertically. Okay. So vertically, XY distance, I'm trying to, with a compass, I create a arc and I cut a distance of how much? I cut a distance of the XY distance that I have calculated here. Now this XY distance would be the lines that are cutting here. Now what I do is I simply extend the horizontal and the vertical lines, and we have the conical projection that is being formed. Here the parallels are the curved lines, meridians are the straight lines. meridians meet at a point. If I am trying to represent North Pole, South Pole is not possible with the same conical. There would be extreme distortions that would be seen. So conical projection is true only for one half of the hemisphere that you are trying to do. Okay, the scale is true best where? Best at the region of standard parallel. At the standard parallel, that is, there is maximum conservation of area and shape that is being maintained, and towards the polar areas obviously you have maximum distortion, reduction in the shape and reduction in the size and distortion in the shape as well. Also, this projection is neither equal area projection, neither this is an orthomorphic projection that could be seen. The major limitation is extreme distortions towards the polar areas, both in case of area, shape and conservation of size. So complete distortion at the region of polar areas that could be seen. The best regions that could be represented are the regions along the standard parallel. Since the scale is true best at the standard parallel, anything you are trying to draw along the standard parallel would be best. So let's say I am trying to draw a trans railway line. So let's say Canadian Pacific Railway or trans Russian Railway, trans Siberian Railway. So that would be best because it would be running onto one single standard parallel. So all the transport networks which are running on a single latitude or a single parallel, or any of the international boundaries between, let's say, United States and Canada would be a good example, because those are running at a same parallel. So anything which is going on the same parallel or the same latitude would be best represented by this conical projection with one standard parallel that we have done today. So those were three of the important examples for developing projections that we have covered. We would be covering many more interesting topics in practical geography. Stay tuned with us for more updates. Have a wonderful day ahead.